we say, everybody in here believing, okay, raise your hand, you're saved, is that straightforward? Well, let me jump ahead and say no. Saved from, let's go back to some verses, because I only read the first half of a couple of verses. The one that you know well from Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And I'm about to say something here that I hope nobody has any tomatoes or stones or anything, because you might want to throw them, but I'm just bracing them. But starting with this is kind of interesting, isn't it? That the wages of sin is death, but the gift is salvation. Which means you earn death. You earn hell. You work for it. But the other thing that you really want is a gift. So it puts us right smack dab in the middle of guess whose fault it is. Who's accountable then? We earn death. But the gift is Christ himself. The other verse we looked at from Romans 7 said, Richard, you know, I do what I don't want to do and all of this. And he goes out, concludes like this, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Who will deliver me? Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, I want you to catch a subtlety here. Jesus Christ doesn't save you. Gee, I expected at least some gasps or something. You guys are like, no fun. Ron has a thing. Yeah, that would hurt, Ron. Jesus Christ doesn't save you. Whoa, what am I saying? Who does save you? Well, see, here's what we're getting at that's reading this verse, is Jesus Christ simply a belief. You know what? Demons believe, and probably more certain than you are because they've seen him eye to eye, that who Jesus is. It's not belief in itself that saves you. In there, it's so important, let me transliterate, exact word for word, from that Greek, through Jesus Christ, the Lord of us. Through Jesus Christ, the Lord of us. Lord, Kyrios. And if you were looking for an exact translation, it means supreme authority. It means controller. See, believing in Jesus himself means absolutely nothing. It's the lordship that starts the salvation into action. The lordship starts there. Let me bring it back into our physical illustration just to try and set up a mental picture for us. Our hurricane expert, Van Heerden, pointed out that there were 57,000 families in New Orleans who did not own a motor vehicle. They did not have a car of any kind. They were that poor that they didn't have any kind of vehicle. And the bottom line of all of this history on this was those people then did not have a way to get out. That was his point in the beginning. He said, these people will not get up. And sure enough. Well, I want you to imagine you are one of those people. Because spiritually speaking, you are. Spiritually speaking, you are. There you are, and now it is the day before the storm. There you are on August 27th, I believe it is. And there you are, everyone else who had the common sense and the means to do it has left. They have been saved. There you are, sitting, waiting to face the storm. Inevitable. Not really any hope. So as you're sitting there out on your front porch watching the clouds roll your way, up pulls the biggest, most beautiful, most luxurious mobile home you have ever seen. And it pulls up and the driver honks in that horn and the hand comes out the window and goes, yeah, you're ahead of me there, Pam. And you see this come on over sign, and all you have to do, you go over to this vehicle that you don't even have hope of, if you worked all your life, couldn't afford this thing. And the door is open, and all you have to do is get on board. Now, you don't get to drive. It's not your vehicle. Because the guy at the wheel, he is the supreme authority. He's the controller. All you have to do is get on, sit down, and let him take you where he wants to go. So you do it. You get on. You keep going, and you see the waters are about to rise, and these waters, think of them as all the wrongs are flooding in. And they're all the judgment is about to come in. Everything that as nations, as cultures, as individuals, we have stubbornly persisted in and walked away from God. That storm, that water is going to rise very, very soon. But all you have to do is accept this gift of stepping into this mobile home. And so you do. You step in there, and off you go, and in the rear view mirror, you see the storm approaching. That's what it means to be saved from. We need it. And we need to understand it's some nasty stuff that we are saved from. But if you remember what happened in, during the time of this hurricane, and there was a real travesty, is where people were taken out, and then they were bussed out and everything, and so they were saved from. But they were dropped in whatever states, all over the place, hotel rooms, whatever, and they were kind of like left. Well, that's not really fully saved, is it? I mean, you're saved from, but here comes the important thing. Unless you're saved to, you're not fully saved. You're saved from something, but you need to be saved to something. And that's where we run into a problem in Christianity, is people are pretty big on being saved from past things, but not so much in being saved to. Saved from the nasties, okay, but saved to. See, in Scripture, as we look at it, Galatians 5, for instance, it explains, it says, the work of the flesh are evident. The works of the flesh are evident. So it goes on and it tells a whole bunch of nasty stuff that we tend to do when we're not saved from the storm. But the verse doesn't stop there. It goes on to say, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control. Against this stuff, there's no storm. So, see, the bottom line is you get emptied of something, but that's only half the picture. Then you must be filled with something. If you just go to the empty part, which a lot of Christians try to do, let's just get rid of the nasty stuff, what do you end up with? You end up with empty people. It's no wonder that we see not the power in our Christianity that we should. Because we get as far as the empty, but it's not true salvation. Salvation is being emptied from and then filled with. There's an empty and there's a filled side to both of us. That's the full picture of salvation. That's what it's all about. What we were saying, you're being saved too. So you are filled with joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control. Those are things that help you in the personal storms. Those things that may turn your life into a hell, even right now. The foreshadow of the big picture. But if we go back to our analogy, that's still not the whole thing of what you're saved to. Let's go back and thinking in this story, kind of a fairy tale that didn't happen to the folks from New Orleans. But imagine now you're back in that big old mobile home and you are looking in the rear view mirror and you have been saved from. And you go, okay, fine, where are we going? And this driver, whom you get to love a whole lot because he is just like this amazing person. He's got a beard and sandals and all of this stuff. And as you go along, he takes you to a place that is so beautiful that where you left behind, you're not even homesick. But it doesn't even end there. Once you get to where you're going, he says, here's your stop. He pulls up in front of this beautiful mansion and passes you a set of keys and says, here's your house. Here's your stop. Sounds ridiculously fairy tale, doesn't it? But consider this, John 14, verse 1, Jesus, the guy driving with the sandals and the beard, by the way. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. When Jesus left this place, it was in preparation for you, personally. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. Where I am, there you will be also. See, there's the good news of all of this, is you're not just saved from something, you are saved to something. The to something starts in this life. What is it? It is you being able to live the exact reason and purpose you've been put on this planet for. To live for that, and that even when the storms do come, because we do all face storms of some kind, you are empowered to be able to face them. You're saved to that. And then there is the moving on to the big picture, the mansions, yet to come. All of this certain. There's a whole bunch of certainties here. The first big certainty is there is a storm coming. And the personal one will come. And all you have to do is follow the course of sin. Guarantee whatever it is for you, that's the eye of the storm, you will face naturally the consequences. But just as certain as there's a way out, It involves a supreme authority. It involves the guy, not in a mobile home, but on a cross. Not opening a door, but a tomb. Resurrected, an example for you that it is absolutely true. The whole name of this goes back to the sermon, to that last slide, those young men up on the rooftop. And I often, what makes it so thought-provoking in there is, the water is rising. Man, Van Heerden's words are coming to mind, first slow, then quick. Man, you guys are dead. And they must have realized it as they watched this. But the way it ends with the word please, and I look at it and say, there's only two reasons I can think of the word ends up spelt like that. And both of them fit a spiritual principle. One is that they didn't have enough knowledge in themselves to spell the word right. And you know what? That's a lot like us spiritually. We don't even have the power within ourselves to really even ask if the Holy Spirit asks for us. That's why they surrendered to God. The second reason could be that they expended all their resources and ran out before they could even finish the sentence. They didn't have enough in themselves even to completely ask. Either way is a profound illustration of where we are spiritually. But then I imagine the helicopter shooting that picture. Can you imagine what it would feel like? That you're on that rooftop. There's guys laying down everything, so they've been there a while. And they know that water is going to kill them pretty soon. And along comes this ride. How your hope would change in that instant. How the urgency for that vehicle would be. That's really where the whole thing of the gospel is. The good news is, well, it starts with bad news. Actually, it starts with, there's a storm coming, and you're going to die. Sorry, it doesn't sound nice, warm, and fuzzy, but that's the truth of it. The storm is coming. And then, the real good news is, your ride is alive. Here's your ride.